So, hello everyone, welcome to this focus group 4. Today, we are going to, first of all, I'm Andrea Mazza, maybe it's better to present myself. I'm from Politecnico di Torino, I'm an electrical engineer, so I work basically on distribution systems and now from 2 years also multi-energy systems. Today we are going to make this focus group regarding smart cities, smart grids, and digitalizations, modeling insights and lessons learned. I see you see my screen, and the session will be recorded. So I hope everyone is good with this. And we will have a very, very tight program. In this session we will have 4 speakers: Edoardo Corsetti from RSE, Vittorio Verda from Politecnico di Torino, Cristiana Botta from Links Foundation, and Gianluigi Migliavacca again from RSE. The topic covered will be quite wide because we are starting with multi-energy systems in the urban environment that goes to the flexibility that we can we can get from the resources existing in the cities. Then we are going to take a look on the electrification of the transport, and finally the evolution of the role of distribution system operators. This discussion, 5 minutes presentation, will be preliminary with respect to the 4 focus group, in which there will be a discussion regarding the different topics that I mentioned before. Please note that every group has a capacity of 25 persons, so if one subgroup is full, opt for another. If all the groups are full, come back to the GoToWebinar, but from the number of participants I can see it, probably this kind of situation will not happen. After that there will be the results of the discussion and the results outcomes and the concluding remarks. So I'm not going to waste time, only a picture that of the of our speakers that you can see also online now. So the first speaker will be Edoardo Corsetti. So welcome, Edoardo. So I will leave the floor to you to show your slide now.
Thank you very much, Andrea. Okay, I am Edoardo Corsetti, I'm from RSE, and currently I'm involved in the Magnitude project. So the discussion that I am going to moderate is mainly oriented to the Magnitude context and in some way results. Let me propose first of all a definition for what we mean as a multi-energy system. Multi-energy system is smart city, so in particular we are talking about residential, commercial and tertiary buildings, district heating and cooling, campuses, industrial sites, incinerators, and so on. So we have a huge amount of multi-energy system in the urban environment. The main features of this kind of system is these are the main features, but obviously they are not exhaust the all the overall feature that these systems should have. So we are talking about system with multiple energy transformation process, so technology. We are talking about a system with multi-carrier demand, so demand side management in some way, and in some sense also prosumer. And the last but not least, the markets in terms of procurement and provision of energy carriers. But recently, the strong point is the as the multi-energy systems are meant as an ancillary service provider. So from this point of view, what we are discussing in the subgroup is the issue and potential of current modeling frameworks, equipment and analysis codes enabling the control of multi-energy system integration. And the last point is the electricity and multi-energy systems, electricity service providers in terms of potential and barriers. And so the proposal is a common platform to assess multi-energy system in the market regulation. So that's it, and I am happy to discuss with you later on these subjects. Okay, Andrea, you can keep the control now.
Thank you very much for being also in the time. Thanks, Edoardo. So the next, first of all, I forgot to tell to the audience, you can use posing some question in case the question panel and the chat panel of GoToWebinar. So please write them there, and I will collect the question in case to make, especially for the final discussion, some points to be discussed. So thank you very much again, Edoardo. So let's go to the next presenter. That is Vittorio Verda from Politecnico di Torino. I will provide you the right to share your screen.
Okay. So the topic here is related with the renewable and flexibility resources in city, how we can integrate and exploit them. The idea is to share some information now coming from the project called Recognition, where we want to study the demand of buildings using renewables. So the actions we are considering are the development of renewable sources tailored for residential installations, to developing intelligences to optimally plan and operate these technologies, also to consider possible storage and demand side management approaches. And final, last but not least, I want to put in this list also the integration of the various networks as a strategy to take advantage of the various resources, renewable resources, in an optimal way. In the project, we are developing technologies, the platform, and we want to test them in six pilot sites. And these are the technologies we are developing. It's a vertical axis wind turbine, a solar cooling system, some building integrated photovoltaics, a cogeneration system based on biogas, and a compact latent heat storage unit for thermal energy. And the key points are, well, of course, the technologies, and then the software, which are linked together with an intelligent gateway. This is an application example in which we optimize the electricity, heating and cooling demand, taking advantage of the various resources. And last but not least, I'd like to mention the outcomes from a different project, which is also mentioned here in this panel, which is Planet. Here we are also discussing the multi-energy networks as a way to take advantage of the production of the different renewable systems. Particularly in this picture, I'd like to mention some features that are exploiting in the Planet project, which is the use of cogeneration system, the use of heat pumps to link together the electricity and the thermal networks, the use of thermal storage as a very nice way also to store somehow excess electricity productions, but also the use of power to gas, which is used to link the gas network, the electricity network, but also the excess heat is used in the district heating system. So these are the topics we want to discuss in the subgroup.
Thank you, Vittorio. So thanks for your very clear and let's say very clear presentation. So we are going to the next speaker, that is Cristiana Botta from Lynx Foundation. Cristiana, you have already your screen shared, so please, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Andrea. Can you see my screen?
Yes,
so,
we can see.
The topic now is the electrification of transportation at city level. And I want to show you the main results, the main output of the Insight TV project. Insight TV is the project of the Horizon 2020 program that aims to demonstrate innovative set of charging infrastructure, technologies, and business model to improve the EV user experience, fostering the EV market share in Europe. This is a very big project that lasts 4 years with a consortium of 33 partners from 8 countries. The coordination is by the Renault Group. One of the main goal of this project is the development of the Decision Support System, a DSS, that want to support mobility planners and policymakers in the development of specific actions to foster, to push the penetration of electric vehicles in the cities, through the development of user-centric charging infrastructures. That means infrastructure that meet the specific needs of users. The DSS modules will be composed by four sub-modules: the user behavior modules that models the mobility habits of drivers, for instance, how much they travel, how much they spend time with the car parked, and when they decide to recharge vehicles. Then there is the charging infrastructure module that provide data and information about existing charging infrastructure in the city, but also information about the best location for new infrastructure. The mobility modules want to minimize the service time for each user. What is the service time? It is the time that each user used to recharge the vehicle. So the third time plus the queue time plus the charging time. And the second goal of this model is we want to avoid congestions on road network as a result of the tour of trips of vehicles that are looking for a charging station and want to recharge. The last module is the power module. It supports in understanding grid-related requirements, restrictions, potential, and cost when we want, for instance, to set up a new or additional or change in the location of charging infrastructures. This is an example of the structure of the mobility module. Each module will be organized in the sub-modules. In this case, we can see 7 sub-modules. The OD matrix modules that gives information about the original destination of the trip made by vehicles. the parking modules that give information on parking habits of the user, the sizing and seating modules that give information about the location and the number of electric charging station in the city. And then there is the EV penetration module that try to estimate the number of EV vehicle that will travel on the city network. And the price model that gives information about the price of electric charging station. Each module has an output, a list of KPI that are used to compare different scenarios and in order to optimize in a conjunct manner all the impact on the network. That's all. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Cristiana, for your presentation. Very nice. So the last but not the least, Gianluigi Migliavacca from RSE. Probably you have already the right. Yes, so the floor is yours, please.
Okay, Andrea, can you see my screen?
Yeah, we can see it. That's
okay,
fine.
Perfect. Thank you very much. I'm Gianluigi Migliavacca. I'm a project manager at RSE, and I'm for the third time coordinator of a Horizon 2020 project now. Whose name is FlexPlan. This presentation and then the subsequent discussion in the focus group is related to the experience gained in this project as well as in the previous one that was finished in the middle of 2019, whose name was SmartNet. So about the changing role of DSO, of course the DSO is subject to a considerable changing in the system as it is structured and as it works. In principle, those are the main issues that are there now. First of all, as everybody knows, the increased risk penetration in distribution, especially from photovoltaic power plants, but not only. Also, small wind power plants are located in distribution. And that introduces a team of flow variability that is typical of RES injection. And as far as the flows on the networks are concerned, creates a short duration congestion that has to be managed and possibly managed in a different way with respect to the traditional means. Then, due to injection into the distribution becomes an active network. That means that there is also power that remounts from the leaves to the primary substation that connects the distribution network with the transmission network. And that is something that has to be taken into account also in the planning, as well as in the operation. And there is an increasing system for storage systems as something that can compensate variability of RES generation. So something that could be also useful in distribution, as well as something that is very typical of distribution, that is the evolution of flexible load towards flexible load of the load that was once upon a time rigid and immutable. And the empowerment of the customer and the theme of local communities that is dedicated a lot of attention in the last time. Of course, there is also something that doesn't necessarily happen in distribution that is influencing this process. And first of all, of course, the decommissioning of big conventional power plants in transmission that is making that amount of power in percentage injected by the RES more and more. And that creates more variability and more need for a server in the system. And then the evolution of the real-time markets that are more and more integrated also at European level. So all those inputs create three needs, in my opinion, in particular. the need to be active part by the DSO in organizing ancillary services for solving local problems, the need to work coordinate with the TSO for services procurement in a market environment, and the need to abandon the fit and forget planning based on worst case that was typical of the case in which there was no injection in distribution and the load was fixed. All that needs, of course, some new regulation. And the prompts in the regulation in the new directive on internal electricity market part of the winter package are essentially two, one for operation and one for planning. For operation in comma one of Article 32, it is written that all member states should provide the necessary regulatory framework allowed to provide incentives to distribution system operators to procure for flexibility services, including congestion management in their areas. As far as planning is concerned, it is written in comma 3 that the distribution system operator should publish at least every 2 years a development plan, as it is already the case for transmission system operators. And in that plan, we should also include the use of demand response, energy efficiency, and energy storage facilities. And so that is should be an alternative to system, traditional system expansion. So I want to produce a couple of conclusions from two important projects, SmartNet, that investigated markets and operation, and FlexPlan that is now investigating the planning side. From the point of view of SmartNet, we investigated the most of all TSO-DSO coordination schemes in a market environment in order to understand which can be the most effective one. And we carried out some reflection on the fact that local congestion markets would be fine, but are subject to a series of limitations and inefficiencies due to the division of the optimization process in sub-processes and to the necessity to ensure liquidity that is not to be given for granted in small markets as the ones, local ones, managed by the DSO. As far as the FlexPlan project is concerned, we are investigating the fact that storage and flexibility can replace, in some cases, refurbishment of the network and creating new lines. And that is a process that should include both national regulatory authorities that are the ones that should be incentivization for the investment in different nodes of the networks and so locational signals to the investors, and the TSOs on the other side that provide investment plans in which opportunities are highlighted for an optimized investment. So a coordination in this triangle of subjects and arrays and TSOs, DSOs, and on the other side, investors should be put in place. From that, the questions, but I will come back to the questions during the subgroup debate, and so I would postpone them to that phase. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Gianluigi, for your very interesting presentation. So I will get again the, let's say, the right to share the screen, because now it's time, let's see if I'm able to do. Yes, it's time to take a look. We are quite in time, so this is fine. The results, let's say, of the survey that have been, let's say, put online the days before this focus group. And here there is, let's say, the results. First of all, it is, as mentioned by Gianluigi, that somehow the same question will be proposed and discussed better, maybe driven by the moderator and the subgroups. Why? Because the results, due to the number of answers not so big, cannot be considered significant. I tried to draft some, let's say, some ideas, partially already mentioned by Edoardo in his presentation. So the first one of the questions said if there is existing of suitable tools for multi-engine systems, Okay, among the few questions, the few answers that arrived, most of them said no. While a minority of them highlighted that some of them exist. Actually, one of them highlights a very, very large, let's say, review on it. So what personally I got from this is that the knowledge of these systems is not widespread among the scientific community. So it is necessary probably, even because, let's say, the topic is somehow put together different backgrounds, so it's also difficult to really understand if you are not going to into detail what is going simulate in any tools. Then there is the equipment for monitoring and controlling mass is suitable for the control, for the monitors and so on. All the answers said no. So it is a sort of a necessity to go more in detail in this research for the equipment. And let's see if it's okay. It is requiring a common platform. I mean, a platform in the sense of think tank, let's say, including government, different stakeholders, so on, to enhance the potential flexibility of MES, yes, from all the customers. And this one was the part related to the multi-energy systems. Then there was the role of the DSO, in which there was the standardization as a key point, and the way to provide the service, let's say a market rules framework is seen as fine. Instead, other question, for example, related to the storage in the planning role and the TSO-DSO coordination mechanism, didn't have a real clear answer, and actually also few. So this one, it will be left to Gianluigi in the subgroup. So I guess that with quite in time, incredible, we arrived to the situation in which we can go to let's say to the subgroups. I will ask let's say if there is any question. First of all, just we have few minutes left with respect to the scheduled time. If there is any question from the participants, please use the let's say the question and the chat. Probably you see the question panel. You can write the questions, and they will provide to the moderator, or let's say for discussing it. Let's say no question from the audience, as far as I see. So I guess that we can go to the different subgroups. I will ask, let's say, to the organizer to tell us which is the situation in such a way that we can go there. Thanks. So we start from the first subgroup, that is the one of Edoardo. Is Edoardo here? Not yet. So we pass to the group of Vittorio. Please, Vittorio.
Okay, so what we have discussed in the group was mainly related with two subjects. The first one is something that wasn't mentioned before, related with the integration of industrial players. And that's something which might be of interest probably for the entire group, since one of the main issues here is related with how it's possible to create incentives for implementing like demand side management strategies for industrial players. And a second issue we discussed was related with the different characteristics of the industrial players with respect to residential players in terms of demand profile, which is, of course, well, often at least easier to predict because of the schedules. But a difficulty is related with the diversity of the various players. Second topic we discussed was related with the characteristics of the technologies for renewable uses in urban environment. Particularly, there were a few questions related with the characteristics with respect to larger size technologies and the characteristics we mentioned were related with photovoltaics and wind turbines. In the case of photovoltaics, what you are expecting is is a better integration in buildings. So the characteristics, it's particularly interesting is the possibility to have like colored systems or systems characterized, technology characterized with the lightweight, so that it's possible to integrate in an easier manner in buildings. While in the case of wind turbines, we discussed the issue related with the vibrations, which is something that you want to avoid when integrating these technologies in an urban environment.
Okay, thank you.
So these were the discussions in terms of results, which was something that you were asking before. We just made some statements that these are the results.
You can send to me the statements and then I will provide in an overall document. Thanks. Okay, Gianluigi, please. Gianluigi, can you hear me? No. Gianluigi? Cannot hear us? Okay, we pass to, oh yes. Luigi, we cannot hear you. So we pass to Edoardo then, and you can try to fix the problems. Edoardo, a few words about your subgroup. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. I had a very interesting discussion with the people that proposed the paper concerning the classification of a huge amount of multi-energy system modeling tools and codes. And he is proposing a classification of the different system to be modeled, the functionality to be modeled. And this is an interesting suggestion in order to propose a common platform for the new needs as emerging from the energy system. Afterwards, we discuss in detail a few results that REC gained within the Magnitude project concerning the provision of service, electrical services by multi-energy systems, and the issue emerged through in this work, the issue and the potential, because surely there is an economic convenience by the multi-energy system operator to participate to this kind of services, and there is also an interesting from the power system, which are in these years asking for a huge amount of flexibility, and these multi-energy systems, especially those involved in the urban environment, can be a reliable and a support to the flexibility. At the same time, what we experience is a number of barriers, in particular for regulation, which impose rules that frustrate the available flexibility of this system, and also market in some cases require specific tariff and costs for this for the provision of services, but these costs for services that are for systems that are mainly related to other commitment, not the electrical one, it appear not suitable. And so, in some way, we for the summary of this focus group, subgroup in the focus group could be that we need a classification of system functionality and in particular services that the multi-energy system can provide in order to fix some points for the next energy system. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you for this, Gianluigi.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, now yes, very clear.
Okay, thank you. So, well, my group was a little bit not so big a tendency in that group. So at the peak we had four people in that group, but in any case we had a sort of micro debate in it on two themes. First of all, about storage and flexibility in planning, to what extent it is to be considered as something that could be taken into account by the planner, to take into account the possibility to adopt advices to invest in planning or in flexibility, so to say. A first speaker was from a European project that is taking into account planning issues for sector coupling and takes the approach of cellular energy approach. Actually, they are only considering lines and not flexibility and storage in their planning approach. But nonetheless, he thought it could be an interesting plus for it. Another person who was from a big producing group and from an aggregation group in France said that it is important that there is a clear definition of services and products. So of course it can be a profitable business for them or to be conceived also to support the planning, congestion plan, so preventive congestion management, but of course they need to know exactly how to bid, how to participate into the market, what are the mechanisms that for this new possibility are offered. Then there was a big manufacturer present who said that of course they are selling apparatuses also for data exchange, and of course storage and flexibility are good opportunities, especially when they are placed in non-densely populated areas. Then there is a strong need also to exchange information and to make it a communication channel available, and so that is an opportunity also for them. Then from the point of view of the operation, we discussed the issue of the procurement of ancillary services, and if it is a good opportunity and it is right that the DSOs organize a market and procure on themselves services, or they should be in any case together with the TSO in the sense of a common market, or in any case in communication with them. So I had a student, a PhD student, a French student that studies in Denmark. He's a market specialist also for real-time markets. He says that in his opinion, the TSO-DSO coordination is very important, of course, whatever mechanism is adopted. But in any case, he sees more the TSO on the side of ancillary services. I try to interpret possibly he wanted to say balancing with that. And DSO on the side of congestion. But my question is that also the TSO area, so auto transmission, is subject to congestion. In any case, there is a problem that is crossing two areas, and how should it be tackled together? In any case, is was correctly pointing out the fact that we should avoiding what technically speaking is called the counterfeiting action. So the fact that by acting the TSO destroys the action of the DSO and vice versa, so they should coordinate on it. Finally, there was again from production and group in France that issue that it is difficult to say whether the DSO should be the primary subject to make a congestion management in distribution, or should be a coordinated market or a coordinated process. But for sure, what is important is that there is a coordination in place that avoids that there is a big inefficiencies in that procurement process. Of course, well, the debate remained at that level, so I could take as a final conclusion the fact that it's important that whatever is done, that coordination between TSO and DSO is maintained, and that the products are defined clearly, so that every subject is, so to say, knowing what are the rules of the play that have to be of this game. Well, okay. I invited everybody to see the conclusion of the SmartNet project, where we have, of course, investigated for 3.5 years this kind of subject.
Thank you very much, Gianluigi. Thank you for the brief and clear summary of your subgroup. Then we are going with the last subgroup, that is the one where I was the moderator, so the electrification of the transport. I decided, let's say, in according with all the participants, to answer to some questions. So first of all, what is an electric vehicle? What was emerging that there is no clear definition of electric vehicles. There are people that are considering electric vehicles only battery electric vehicles. There are other people that are considering also the fuel cell electric vehicles, even consider the plug-in electric vehicles as electric vehicles. So first of all, it is necessary that the first outcome is no clear definition, according to the sensibility of each of us can change. The second point is it is necessary to recognize enablers and barriers very clearly, and we list some of them. The first is the willingness of the customer to use electric vehicles, okay, which is depending on the usage of the vehicles that they have to make, depending on the type of let's say if there's the only car in the family or the second car, and so on and so forth. So this one is the first real issue, let's say, understanding which are the needs of the customers and the goings towards to satisfy them. The second is the technical limitation that still affects some of the electric vehicle existing in terms of capacity of the batteries, in terms of kilometers. This one is actually, this problem is actually coupled with the first one. So according to the usage, some of the batteries, some of the vehicles cannot reach what the customer wants, or maybe can be reached only with very expensive electric vehicles so far. So it is necessary to understand also this kind of issue. The second is that is the necessary infrastructure, but not only electrical infrastructure. For sure, it is necessary to have the transformer that work properly, but also the spaces, okay? We have need spaces to install our own charger, okay? We cannot install if I have my electric car, I would like to have my charger in the street, because probably there will be some not good action from, let's say, some from the people around. And finally, but last but not the least, the share mobility. The neighbors can be the share mobility also in terms of public transportation. It is a news of today that here in Torino, the municipality bought other 50 electric vehicle buses. So this one is a good thing. Because probably this one can be created like a flywheels, okay? This side of a possibility to increase the electrification of the transport. Then we so this one is the how, before the what and then how. And then the last was a very brief why. Okay, because everyone thinks electrification, but why? Because at the end, what was evident was the reduction of the local pollution, okay, in the cities, because we are focused on the cities, that can also provide a sort of improvement of the global environmental quality, okay, global, not only local, but also globally. So the two, let's say, level of the pollution, local and global, okay? So this one was the last subgroup. I think that I have 30 seconds to thank everyone. What I can make as a concluding remark is that all these topics has pointed out the necessity to define something, okay? The definition of the electric vehicle is my case, the definition of the services that can be provided for the MES. The definition of what we can use the flexibility, what kind of flexibility, the definition of the interaction between TSO, DSO. So what we really need is somehow to define the boundaries, okay? The boundaries where the different policymakers can act to enabling this kind of transition. So I hope that you somehow enjoyed this session. And so I thanks everyone for the participation, and see you next time. Bye bye.